you come face to face with the devil tonight? Will you pick up where you left off when you start to fight? When you feel alone and you're as dark as night, know what's wrong, but boy, it sure feels right. And oh, you're like whiskey to my soul. You're home when I got no place to go. So come on in and tie me down. Well, take me out to town. I got a feeling we've been taking the long way around. Is it just fantasy? Honey, is it just make believe? You're awakening the monsters deep inside of me. Burn my soul when you touch my skin. I'ma cause you pain if I let you in. Because you taste like honey and you smell like gin. Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. And oh, you're like whiskey to my soul. You're home when I got no place to go. Come on and tie me down. Well, take me out to town. I got a feeling we've been taking the long way around. Is it just fantasy? Honey, is it just make-believe? You're awakening the monsters deep inside of me. Take me out to town. Got a feeling we've been taking the long way round. Is it just fantasy? Honey, is it just make-believe? You're awakening the monster deep inside of me. So come on and tie me down. Take me out to town. I got a feeling. I've been living in the shadows, shining light on me.
What is going on, everybody? Hope everybody is having a wonderful Monday so far. Welcome to the first ever Monday study hour. So I don't have time to play on Mondays, but Monday is always a good time for me to get in a little bit of study. I usually have an hour to study before I play my home game tonight. We have my buddies come over and we play some cards. So anyway, I'm going to start something new here to keep myself accountable for studying on Mondays by having a 1 hour stream here on Mondays to do some kind of study. So something I was thinking about today was about facing Donk aggression. You know, this is something that we hardly ever study, you know, but we get in those hands, especially now that I'm playing more so on some softer sites like Global Poker and on PP Poker, that we face these weird donk bets. So we're the ones who are aggressive, and all of a sudden on the river, our opponent bets into us out of position. So we bet the flop, we see bet the flop, we see bet the turn. And all of a sudden, we're faced with this donk aggression. What do we do? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to break out CardRunners EV, and we're going to break down a tree and get to that decision point when we are facing that donk bet and figure out what exactly should we be doing in that spot. What's the most plus EV play? We'll take a look at our range, and we'll take a look at the range of somebody who would make this kind of bet. Now, really only recreational players are making this kind of bet, and it's kind of hard to put recreational players on a range, but we're going to do our best. So without further ado, what I'm going to do first is I'm just going to grab my database here. And the database I've set up is for us being the button in position in a single race pot. And of course, we are the we're the preflop raiser, obviously. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to add a filter for the river where we have an opportunity to raise a donk bet. And let's save this here. And let's go and take a look at the reports. And obviously it doesn't, you know, it doesn't happen all too often, but it happens enough. And I want to kind of see what we'd be doing in that situation. So I think here's a good one here where we bet, and then fold. Now, I'm going to replay the hand here. Now you're going to see that we don't actually have information here. No cards. I'm not displaying any cards here. So first, let's like take a look at preflop and just see, make sure this qualifies. Okay, perfect. And we're just going to take a look at the action real quick in this hand. So as you can see here, we are the preflop raiser. Let me actually minimize this a little bit for you guys. So this way then it's not. That should be good. Okay. So we had a preflop raiser, and the small blind calls us. So we're going to have to figure out a range, of course, to put the small blind on. There will also be some hand reading that goes along with this as well in this activity. So here we have a rainbow board, and it's a paired board. So our opponent checks to us here, and let's see what date this hand was played at to get an idea of where I was. This was May. Okay. And we throw out a half pot c-bet here. Our opponent calls it. And now we get a seven of diamonds. Again, our opponent checks. We bet. Our opponent calls. And then our opponent donks into us. So what in the hell is he donking into us with? Well, let's take a look, and we're going to take a look kind of like at percentages of how many times this may be a bluff and how many times it's not a bluff here. So let's go and take a look at the game tree first. Now I'm just going to take this and put this off screen. And I'm going to open up CardRunners EV here. Okay. And button versus small blind. And this was played at NL50. So, but that's not so important just because we're going to be using big blinds anyway. And we're really focused on the decision point of the river. So that is actually what we're going to look at here. So what I want to see is the chips in the pot here. And we're going to break out actually Flopzilla to get ranges up to this point. So we're going to add 26 big blinds. And we're going to start the tree at the river. And what's nice about this is we're going to be able to take a couple of different looks at this from a GTO point of view, from an exploitative point of view as well, and also from an EV point of view. So again, we're starting river, six-handed, button versus small blind. Let's start the tree. Okay. And let's get in the hole cards leading up to there. So we got a three of clubs, and an eight of hearts, and a three of diamonds. And for the turn here, we have a seven of diamonds. And the river, we have a 10 of clubs. Okay, let's break out a couple instances of Flopzilla real quick here, because we're gonna wanna grab some ranges, and we're gonna figure out where we are. So these pre-flop ranges, what I'm going to fill in here, are actually going to be what we believe the ranges are going to be at the turn. But we got to get there first with Flopzilla. So I'm going to open up two Flopzilla instances of Flopzilla here. We're going to have one for us, and we're going to have one for our opponent. So let me open up another Flopzilla. Okay. Perfect. And now I'm going to open up Hold EQ. Hold EQ is going to is actually going to connect both of these Flopzilla screens, so they actually both speak with each other. So now anything we do on one, you will see will also happen on the other. Pretty awesome stuff. Okay, so first we need to come up with some ranges. Well, let's come up with some preflop ranges here. So for the sake of this exercise, I'm going to use this as an opening range here for myself. And I think this looks pretty good. I'm going to make it a little bit wider just because of how I'm playing right now. I'd like to be able to have my range pretty much like I'm playing now, which I'm playing super wide from the button. I'd say this is pretty close to my button opening range right now. Maybe not this wide until this is pretty close to my button opening range right now. Now for a recreational player, this particular player, we can take a look here. Actually, you can see that we only had 25 hands and he was a 25-8. And he has cold call of 60, which is three out of five opportunities. But we know like these guys are going to call really wide. Plus, you should be calling pretty wide here from the big blind versus a button open. So let's pump this up to 60 first, and we'll take out some obvious three bet hands. So here we'll give him more suited hands here. That maybe he'll call with. Maybe he'll call with like a bunch of Broadway stuff that a recreational player might call with. I don't see him calling with these kind of hands here. So I think like this kind of crazy range for this type of player will take away some of these obvious hands that he's probably going to 3-bet. Now, we don't expect him to 3-bet too much. This guy does not look like he is a crazy player. These guys will call these hands right here, for example. So I think this range right here works. And now we got to see how we get to the river. So first things first is, I got to just make this smaller so I have controls. My controls back. There we go. Perfect. So let's go back to the flop. So he checks, we bet. So what are we betting with here? Well, the way I'd be playing this now, and I want to set this up the way I'd be playing this now. Now, sure, the stack is not correct because if I were playing this today, I would be betting one third pot and betting my entire range. So for the sake of argument here, let's do this as if I were playing now and I'd be betting my entire range. Now, what would he be calling with? Let's take a look here.
I just gave Christian a hold assist off to tell his grandma that he hasn't told him yet.
Okay. Cool. All right. So anyway, let's take a look and see what he might be calling with here. So let's drop in three of clubs. Three of clubs, eight of hearts. and three of diamonds. I'm just going to jot this all out here. Let's say, of course, there are some hands that we would think he would raise with, right? So if he had quads, although, all right, we're going to keep quads in there, of course. We'll keep full houses in it. We'll keep those hands in there. Let's say he's not aggressive. Through 25 hands, we didn't even have that kind of information on him. But let's just say he's passive. This hand was played at Global Poker. Players at Global Poker generally are passive players to begin with. So obviously he's going to call with all these types of hands. He's a recreational player, as we know. So he's going to call all of these pairs. There are no open-enders or gut shots at this point. We'll say he'll even call with, like, backdoor flush draws at this point. I mean, he's going to be calling with a ton of his range. We'll just assume that. Even still, all these cards here are still only 57% of his range. But that's because a lot of the board just isn't going to connect here. As you can see, there are 58.9% no-made hands. What's going on there? How is poker? How's everything going? Thank you for joining me here for this one-hour study session, something new I'm starting on Mondays here on Twitch because I don't play on Mondays. So, yeah, this is going to be a new thing here for Monday night. So I appreciate you coming along and checking it out. What we're doing here is we're looking at a situation where we get donked on the river. It's a situation that always makes you uncomfortable. You'd never expect it coming. You c-bet flop, you c-bet turn. All of a sudden, you get donked on a river. So we're just going to kind of try and figure out using CardRunners EV what the hell we're doing here. So I am happy to have you along here. So here we this is the range that we're going to give our opponent when he calls us. Again, I'm c-betting my entire range here. So my range is going to stay completely the same. And yeah, I mean, as you can see here, he's passing through 57% of his hands. So there's a lot of hands that he is actually folding just because of the fact that there's a lot here, again, that does not connect with a rainbow paired board here. Thank you. Thank you, Julius Poker. Yeah, it is. It's an interesting one, to say the least, because we all hate this situation. Nobody likes this situation. Nobody's comfortable in this situation. Okay, so next up. Now, what I've done here, by the way, on CardRunners EV is I've set up a decision point here on the river. So right now, what we're just trying to do is we're trying to figure out what hands both of us are getting to the river with. So let's get back Flopzilla here. And let's go back to the hand here. So we c-bet, our opponent calls, and a 7 of diamonds comes out. So let's drop into 7 of diamonds here. And he checks to us. We now throw out an under bet here. And our opponent calls. So first things first, we got to figure out what we're doing this with. What are we underbetting with? Now, I'm going to do this as if it were me doing it. Like, so I know what I would do here. I know what I would underbet with here. And I think this is important. First, hang on. I got to fix this. I forgot to do one thing. Give myself 100% continuance range. What's wrong here? Oh, hang on. Whoops. Okay. 100% continuance range. Now, the 7 of diamonds comes in. Which is X all this off and go one by one. And figure out how am I getting to this point. All right. So, am I underbetting quads here? No. Am I underbetting full house here? Probably not. I could, though. So, I'm not going to say 100% that I wouldn't underbet full house here. Not for protection, but to get a call. I wouldn't do that all the time, but I'm going to say for the sake of this, yes. I have no straights here, of course. Obviously, there are no straights to be had at this point. 3 of a kind here. I would not be underbetting 3 of a kind. Over pairs, I wouldn't be underbetting. I would definitely be betting more for value here. two pair of games. Again, same thing. Top pair hands. Top pair hands is an interesting one. I could definitely underbet for top hands, pair hands. Would I normally do that? Probably not. But for the sake of this, there are times I could do it. But probably, the thing is, like, it needs protection here against overcards. I don't think I would do that. So I'm gonna say I know I wouldn't do that. Middle pairs, however, I could definitely underbet here for protection. Weak pairs, same idea. Ace high hands, I would definitely be checking back here. No made hands, of course. Flush draws here. I could bet like half pot or bet two thirds pot here. I don't see a scenario that I'm underbetting flush draws, but there could be times I might underbet flush draws. So I'm not going to completely take flush draws out of my range. No flush draw, open-ended straight draw. Same idea as the flush draw, because I'm not just going to want to be underbetting weaker pairs and middle pairs here. I need to have some kind of bluffs in my underbet range as well. So I don't think that just... In fact, I'd like to actually bring this to a combo view. Just take a look here. We got 72 plus 24. So that is 96 combos of pairs. And this gives us 47, so that is 11. Carry the one. My two is 71 bluffs here. Plus we have gut shots as well. So we definitely want to have these hands in our range. This gives us 212 combos. So I think this is realistic. And plus we also have the full houses as well. I think this is realistic for an underbetting range. Again, I normally would not like to do that. But for the sake of this exercise, I think it's okay to go with this range. Because there are times I definitely would underbet here in this spot and just trying to get him to fold out some of those overcards that we're losing to, or that we just don't want to see on the river. In fact, actually, I could tell you one thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take out the better flush draws, because I don't see myself underbetting hands like these. These hands here, I know I'm going to want to be betting larger, because I'm going to want to start building a pot in case I do hit my flush. And also, it might make it easier also to bluff on the river as well. So I'm going to say like the aces and the king hands here. So I think this works. So this is my range. And now let's figure out what it is he's going to be calling with. Now, we think he's probably going to be calling a little bit tighter here. But we also did give him a pretty good price to continue with a lot of hands. That being said, and I'm just going to X these off real quick. That being said, he's a recreational player, right? He's donking on a river. No good player ever would donk on the river. At least not at these stakes. Not at NL50, global poker. It's just not happening. So, what is it he's going to call? Again, you'd like to say that they would call quads here, but a lot of times these passive players will call. They're passive, so they're just going to call. They're not going to raise on the turn. I don't know why. You know, sometimes I guess they're trying to protect their hand by not raising and getting a fold. And then they think, okay, well, now he bets. Why, if I raise it here, he's going to fold. But now on the river, if I donk it, then he's going to probably call. I don't understand like the thought process behind that, but you see that a lot, because actually, if you take a look, I don't have hand to note anymore. I stopped paying for it because it was too expensive. It was $50 a month. But when I looked at these spots on the river, it's more so value than it is bluffs. And I think it's kind of important, and this is what we're going to take a look at is in CardRunners EV, is how many bluffs do they actually have in this spot? Now, let's just say, okay, that they're actually going to be... I really like looking at this better in combo mode. Let's just say that they're going to be calling these hands here and not raising them. So over pairs, two pair hands, and top pair of hands. We gave him a pretty good price. Let's see what kind of middle. What is middle pair here? Middle pair is 7. So we'll give him these. Well, I mean, do we think that he's calling here with these weak pairs a recreational player? I mean, these players love pairs, right? I'm going to say that they would call with all but the twos. The ace high hands, we're going to dump. The flush draws, you know, again, these guys, they love their flush draws. They love them. The open enders too, you know. They're like, oh my God, I have 8 outs. I'm the man. The gut shots, they can't fold draws, right? We've seen it. We've seen it many, many times. And they flip over the card at the end and you say, why in the hell did you call the turn? Give up already. But no, because they don't. Even like the bad gut shots. Had it happen last night. Last night I had a set of queens and I 3-bet. My opponent called and this is actually what made me think of the situation, okay? Is I 3-bet, my opponent called. I had pocket queens. I flopped a set of queens. I'm in freaking great shape, right? The board was like, let's see. The board was, obviously I had my queen. There was another club out there. And it was like 9-5 and my queen. And then on the turn, I bet again. I put out a 2/3. My flop bet was a third pot. With a third third size, 1/3, 33%. The turn, I bet 2/3. It was a... I don't remember what suit it was, but it was like it was a third suit. So we had... one suit, we had 2 clubs, and then we had another suit. Maybe it was a heart. And it was, I'd like to say it was a, let's see, I'm just trying to remember this correctly. It was an 8, right, it was an 8. So I'm pretty sure it was an 8 of hearts, okay? So the board is 9, queen, 5, and then an 8. I bet 2/3 pot. This is at NL20 on PP Poker. I bet 2/3 pot, and my opponent called it. And then river comes, trying to remember. Oh, wait, I'm getting this wrong. So the flop was actually 9-queen-3, right? The flop was 9-queen-3. Then the turn was an 8. And then the river was a 5. And then my opponent donked into me. So my big concern was, he's donking into me. Does he have like Jack 10 and did he hit a straight? Because that would make sense if he had Jack 10. Because, I'm forgetting one other factor. I apologize. This is a complete mess. I'm trying to remember this off the top of my head. All right. Flop was, I bet a third pot. He raised me. I called. Okay. No. God damn it, I totally forgot the hand. The bottom line is, he donked me, and he had called. Maybe he didn't raise at all. Damn it, I forgot the hand. If I could pull up the hand right now, I absolutely would, and I just totally forgot the hand. So, anyway, the point is that... God, wait, he... I'm almost like tempted to pull this up on YouTube real quick, because I have it. Is that 34? Yeah. All right. I'm going to pull this up on YouTube real quick because now I'm like angry that I can't figure this out. And I'm going to show you guys. Or you. Howie's Poker. I'm going to pull this up on YouTube because now this is bothering me. I have it up on YouTube because now like I've explained it and it's really bothering me. And now I feel like I'm just getting everything wrong. And this might be completely off topic, but I started talking about the hands and now I want to show it. So hang on. And I know where it is. I know where it is in the video. So, okay, it's right after this hand. I was actually doing a give and take around here. Okay, here it is. Okay, here it is. Hang on. I'm not gonna have the sound on because I lowered down the sound for this. But this I was actually just doing a test video for myself, testing out the microphone. But we'll take a look here together. Hope you can see it. Can you see it well? Can you see it well on the screen? Oh, sorry, I missed the chat here. River doesn't complete nothing, so strange donk always gets me uncomfortable. The situation of donking on river. This is on PP poker. So let me see if I can make this bigger. Okay, perfect. All right, so I don't have the sound on here, but I'm gonna just go through the hand. Yeah, it does make you uncomfortable. It drives you nuts. I could be getting this hand completely wrong, so I apologize. All right, cool. So here he open raises, okay. And I 3-bet him here. I might be getting this situation completely wrong, and if it is, I apologize. This may be nothing, but I wanted to show the hand anyway. So I 3-bet, and he calls. Eventually. Look, he almost timed out. All right, so here it was, 9, queen, 5. I was close. I was close. So here I throw out a 1/3 size c-bet, which is what I'm doing right now. I am betting 100% of my range. So he checked to me. I bet. Does he raise here? Okay, right. Okay, so he raised the flop. All right, so I just want to pause this for a second. He raised the flop here. So thinking about the hands that he might raise the flop with, right? He's raising the flop with a set of nines, right? A set of fives. He obviously doesn't have a set of queens. We have that. He's raising the flop with possible flush draws. Or maybe an open-ended straight draw like Jack 10 is always possible as well. So those are the types of hands that he's probably raising the flop with. Obviously, I call. So now here's the thing. This is where the donk comes in, right? Not in a turn, but you'll see. So again, he thinks, la-di-da-di-da. He checks. So when he checks, obviously now I'm going to throw out a 2/3 size bet here. Right, exactly. We're not blocking any of these bluffs. He calls, right? And an 8 comes out. And wait for it. Okay, I paused the video. He shoves here. Right? So this is what I'm thinking. There are the big thing I was thinking is this. What could he be doing this with? He could absolutely be doing this with a set, like I said. He could be raising sets here, but there are also plenty of flush draws that completely missed, right? Right, we're only losing to 7-6 or Jack 10, but that's like we can't just put him on a hand like 7-6 or Jack 10 here because there are plenty of value hands that he could be doing this with. Because he could absolutely be doing this with sets, and he could absolutely be bluffing with clubs here, because we don't block any clubs. If I had a club in my hand, you know what? Then I can make a serious case for folding this hand because there's a good chance we might be losing. But again, he's docking into us, so he's telling us he's a weak player because a strong player is not doing this. So he could still even be doing this with a set of fives or a set of nines even. So there's a lot that he's doing this with that we beat. So to me, this is a clear call. So I don't even hesitate. I call, and yeah, he actually had a gut shot, and he had the flush draw. And the point is, on the turn, yeah, this one's impossible to fold, right? But the point is here on the turn. I bet 2/3 pot. So I bet a third pot on the flop. And I call his 3-bet. And I call his raise. Then he checks. I bet 2/3 pot. And he calls. And what did he call? He called a gut shot. Nice. It's a nice combo draw. Don't get me wrong. But he calls a gut shot and a flush draw. on a 2/3 pot bet. So he just calls a draw there. He gets lucky. He hits the gut shot of all things. I'm not even sure if he was thinking about the gut shot here. He might have just been thinking about the flush draw. I have no idea. And what does he do? He just donks into us. Yeah, he actually had a really strong hand. But he just donks into us. So this is my point being, is that these guys on the river, they're donking in these spots. I don't think they're bluffing too often in these spots. I think they're donking more often than they're bluffing in these spots. And I've seen it again with population analysis that over 50% of the time, they're doing this with two pair or better. So the question is, how do we defend against this? Because they're doing it over 50% of the time, but they're not doing it 100% of the time. That's the problem. They're not doing it 100% of the time. Because I've also seen these donk bets come in, and it's like, you're like, what were you doing? They do it with like second pair sometimes. And you're like, okay, thank you. I appreciate the money, right? We've seen that before too, where they just give us money. They basically give us their money. They're an ATM machine. And they say thank you. But more times than not, it's a strong range. So how do we react to that? That's where we are now. So let's go back to this. And yeah, we have to call that because we're not blocking his bluff. So I rarely see this line with lots of bluffs like misses and draws. Yeah, you don't see it too often. But again, I've done the population analysis and people do it. But I think people do it more so not with straight bluffs, but they do it with like weaker pair of hands. So they won't just outright like. So they want to have something, right? They don't want to just bluff with complete air. They want to have something. So this way, then, like if they have like second pair, for example, that they may do this with. Yeah, you will see that. Like a lot of small sizes, a shove, probably not as likely that you're going to see something like this. Yeah, small. Like when you see, yeah, right. You're right. When you see like that small bet size, maybe even like. I wouldn't say like a pot size bet, but you'll see some of these guys actually under bet. But even still, a lot of times they're not outright bluffing. They still have some kind of pair. They still have some kind of showdown value that if they get called, they still have a chance to win. But again, it's a terrible strategy. You know, like the way this guy played this, he was fortunate, of course, that I had a set and I'm calling it. But, you know, if I didn't have anything strong like that, I'm folding to a donk bet and he's never getting paid. You know what the point of this is though? Yeah. They're targeting ace high, right? You know what I think happens is they're, you know, out of position is hard to play even for a reg. Imagine how hard out of position is to play for a recreational player, right? It's got to be so confusing for them to play that they think I just must dunk. What do you use a lot of against weaker players? You said you use a lot. Oh, yeah, well, of course, check, turn. If you're out of position, then, you know, then that's a river pro bet. So at that point, you know, you should absolutely be donking on the river at that point, because at that point, they've given up initiative, you know? So yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's a pretty standard play though. You're going to want to, like if you're out of position and it goes check, then you should be betting pretty much most of your range except for you don't want to bet hands like, you know, middle pair, you know, that have showdown value. You don't want to turn those hands into bluffs or anything like that. But obviously you want to bet all your bluffs and you want to bet all your value hands there out of position when it goes check and you know. In position, I don't like to do it as much because like if I have top pair, I like to just check back most times in that situation because, you know, the good old saying, it's hard to get called by worse. The one thing I do like to do is underbet in those spots. Anyway, so I don't have too much time to do this. So let's just get right to, I want to get to CardRunners EV and just take a look and see what we're doing in this spot. So where were we? Okay, so we're saying that he is doing this with these hands. So now we have our ranges going into CardRunners EV now. I know, because you know what it is? Like, we can go on and on and on and on about it, right? I already went off topic a little bit by showing that hand, but I know we could just talk forever because we love poker and poker is awesome, and talking about the theory of it is even more awesome. Anyway, let's go. All right, so the river is the 10 of clubs. And here our opponent dunks into us with a 28%. This is what is this? Like two-thirds. This is two-thirds, right? So now what we need to do, what is he doing this with? And then we're going to go to CardRunners EV after this. Quads, full house, straight, three of a kind, two pair, top pair. What no made, like, what draws would he have had here? Let's look at our no made hands here. Like, is he just doing this with top pair or better? I mean, well, we got to give him some crappy hands here. Like we said, he can do this with some other pair hands here. I mean, you know, can we say he's going to do this with an eight sometimes? I feel like you have to put these kind of hands in their range, right? So let's put these hands in their range. Let's not even give him like any straight bluffs. Because I can't. The problem is I don't really know. All right, you know what we're gonna do here? Actually, this is what we're gonna do. Actually, we're gonna take this entire range, and actually, it's actually a lot easier to do this in CardRunners EV. I think most OASDs, because if he's a decent player, he wouldn't bluff with flush draws. Because he knows he blocks them. Yeah, but he's not a decent player. that's the problem. I mean, which no made hands, like, what do we have here for straight draws? That would have missed. Like, 8-7-8. I mean, does he have 9-6? 9-6. Like, what would he have? Like, any 9, like 9-5, would he do this with, you think? I mean, let's figure out some hand, like complete bluffs, right? 9-5 would have been a gut shot, right, that missed. What else? Because it was 8-7, 6-5. 6-5 is a gut shot that missed. But you know, it's like a lot of these players with these types of hands, they're just like, all right, I'll just give up. I lost. You know? They're like, ah, well, I lost. I'll just give up now. Yeah. Some pairs would go. It's just so hard to do, like, when you're actually just looking at the combos, right? Because the 10 wasn't there. We got to remember the 10 wasn't there. So, actually, does he have... Well, we have the top pair hands in there too, which is actually, this is another thing that you actually see. Hang on one second. This is another thing you actually see, right? Is you see players like this actually is another thing. You on the turn that on the river want to bluff. Yeah. But actually, and think about it, this is another thing you see a lot, right? Is I totally forgot about this. Right, and we have it here, top pair. A lot of times you see when the river is now the highest card on the board, and they hit their top pair on the river, right? Which he could have been doing this with a hand like 10-9, absolutely, hand like Jack 10, right? That was like you said, that was a draw, And then all of a sudden, they donk river. We've seen that many. You know, you've seen it many times too. And you call it, and they have top pair that they got on the river, right? So that's why a lot of times it could even be top pair here. That when that happens, yeah. All right. So I think this is good. Yeah, exactly, because those hands he was calling with those hands previously anyway. That's how we got here anyway. Because all these other ones here are flush draws. The ace 10, the king 10, the queen 10, those are all flush draws. But he actually has two combos of jack 10. All right, yeah. By the way, he also has a set here too. He's got strong hands. You know, his range can still be very strong. All right, so this is the range we're going to give him here when he donks into us. And we got to see what the hell we're doing with our range that we have. So he is the small blind, and this is his range. And let's grab our range. Because we want our range, obviously, that we got here with. By the way, in case you're curious, in terms of equity, range one is him, range two is us. Obviously, before we even do anything, he has like a ridiculous equity advantage versus us. All right, so he bets 16 big blinds. And now we have some decisions here. To raise, call, or fold. And we'll just say for the sake of this example, he would just call. All right. Actually, hang on a sec. I want to delete this again real quick because I'm going to say that we're either raising all in, calling, or folding. So the hands that we're going to be raising all in with would be anything. I would say on this particular board, I mean, obviously, there is no three of a kind. I mean, it's going to have to be straights or better. And even a straight's going to be kind of scary because it's a paired board here. So I'm going to say, and there's no flushes. I'm going to say, like, we're just shoving full house or better here. Because that's going to be the only hand that we'd want to shove here because of the fact it's a paired board. Because we're going to be kind of scared to shove anything less. Like, shoving a straight here would probably be just like a terrible idea. We're just going to want to call a straight here. Where a full house, you know, we're going to feel pretty confident about that and definitely would want to shove there. So we'd have, you know, 10s over 3s, 7s over 3s, or 8 over 3s. So that's it. That's the only hand that we'd be shoving here. And I guess we could have quads too. So let's not forget about our quad threes that we could have, you know. That's always possible, you know. We could have it. It's global poker, you know. This stuff happens in global poker at least once a session. So let's see. What are we calling here in this spot? Because what I want to take a look at first is just EV of this situation. In fact, actually what I'm going to do here, just for looking at EV, for EV purposes, is let's just say like we'd call with the rest of our range. Obviously we're not going to really do that. Or at least, I don't want to do that. Yeah, all right, let's just do that, just for the sake of this. Let's run this real quick. Right, we have to have him call. Okay. Or fold. Right? I guess we should set this up so the EV is correct. If we shove, what is he calling with here? Let's just say he's going to call with, like, a straight or better, I guess. Do we think this guy would, you know? Yeah, just a straight or better. Let's just say you're just going to call a straight or better. Because it's even two pairs, it's like there really aren't many two pairs that you could possibly have because the threes are out there unless he has, you know, 10-7 or 7-8. Because everything else would be like, oh, if he had Tens were the highest pair he had, which would be a full house. So I mean, do we ever think he's calling with a pair of nines? No. So straight it is, and we'll say he folds everything else. All right. All right, we figured that out on Flopzilla, my bad. So, we just run through these real quick here. So let's see, first our full house hands. Obviously all of our full house hands, we know, we're good. Our straights, I just want to see like in terms of EV, all right? So obviously calling straights here, very plus EV. Two pairs, plus EV. Top pairs, this is interesting, right? All of our tens, plus EV to call. He could be doing this with a full house right now, and it's plus EV to call with top pair. All of them. And that's because we have him donking. We're going to look at a different situation in a second, but that's also because we have him donking all these weaker hands. Middle pair is when it starts to, we got to fold. So middle pair hands at this point now, it's minus EV. Okay, and obviously weak pair hands are going to be the same thing, minus EV, and we don't have to look at no made hands. There's no, I wouldn't believe there's any no made hands to be plus EV, so. So top pair are better, we should be betting with here. If we're assuming that he's donking into us with all of these pairs, okay? Now, obviously, if we said he's just doing this with, let me give him a checking range and we'll just check through. If I edit this and we say he's just doing this with top pair, things will change. Obviously now you can see just right here that Jack 9 and 9-6, which are straights. So check this out, right? Top pair are better. He hits that 10. He was going for that gut shot. He hit the 10. He dunks into us. Straight is it. Even two pair is minus EV. 10-7 and 10-8 is minus EV. It really comes down to player read, paying attention. How aggressive is he? If he's super aggressive, super aggro, he's doing this with a wider range of hands. We can call with top pair or better. If we have seen that he is not aggressive, then we can fold a lot. And we would fold even two pair hands in this situation. Interesting. What do you think about that? This is very interesting, and I'm really glad we did this. I don't think there's really anything else we have to look at here. We've just seen it. Aggro player, top pair are better. Tight player, obviously, we have to play it a little bit differently. Is there another scenario that we can look at real quick here in the 10 minutes we have? Different, like just like a different river card. Let's see. Let's just change the river card. What happens if the flush completes? Let's make it a 10 of diamonds instead. And actually, we got to go to him. We make it a 10 of diamonds instead for the fun of it. Okay. Quads, full house, flush. One thing I've noticed, though, is like when a flush completes on, I don't know if you noticed this too, but when a flush completes on the river, the recreational player gets like really scared. They're like, oh my God, he's going to have a flush. And you're going to see less donks in that situation. Like, don't you agree with that? That you see less donk bets when a flush draw completes on the river? Because recreational players are just scared the hell out of flushes. In fact, I think, like, really, when it comes to c-betting, now, right now, I'm at the point where I'm c-betting 100% one-third pot on the flop. I like it. I like the strategy because it really simplifies things. But, you know, when you see when a recreational player sees a monotone board, they are scared to death. They think you're c-betting. You must have a flush. I'm folding. They will fold top pair in those situations because they're scared to death. Unless one of their cards is the suit that's on the board, they're scared to death. Monsters onto the bed. But for the sake of this argument, let's just go with everything that we said as before, and we'll just go middle pair. And let's just give him this range. Yeah, I mean you can really bet any two cards on monotone. They're scared to death. Versus a recreational player. Versus regs, we know that flushes are very hard to make. So we're not worried about the monotone board. But the recreational player, they don't know that. They're like, oh my God, he's betting. He has a flush. We got to fold. We're scared to death. Our life is over. We have to fold. We're done. Meanwhile, we're sitting there with freaking like, you know, on the button. We're sitting there with freaking like 9-8 offsuit. C-bet. Okay. So let us just change his range. And same idea. I just want to, now we're just going to make this all hands. CardRunners TV, by the way, if you don't have it, is such an incredible program for this type of stuff. For running through these different scenarios. I mean, I love game trees to begin with. It's such a great program. We got to change this to 10 of diamonds. Okay. So now, what are we doing? This is, again, he is an agromaniac. He's betting all this stuff here. What are we doing? What are we calling with now when the flush completes? We're still in the same situation with the full house, no matter what. We're shoving. So now, obviously, looks like all of our flushes are still plus EV. We're calling all of our flushes. We're still calling all of our straights. We know flushes are hard to hit. Our two pair hands, again, he's aggro, right? Top pair. Same thing. Same exact thing. Even when the flush completes, and he has so many flushes, right? He had very little straights. He had minimal combos of straights. He had a ton of flush draws here. So we're still calling top pair better. And that's what you need to know. You got an aggro player. You just call top pair better. And again, I bet we're going to see the same exact thing. If he's betting top pair, we're probably just flushes are better, I would assume. Now, real quick after this, I'm just going to run through. We're going to go back to the original hand and just run through the max exploit tool real quick. And the that's really the hand. I'm really more concerned with the max exploit tool. That's weird. We're not running. I'm running right now, Hooden. I think that error is on your end. Okay, cool. Okay. So what were we doing here? The question was, all right, so now we're saying he's betting top pair better. So now, yeah, you panicked me for a second. Even though the stream is almost over, but so we're calling with flushes. We're plus EV on straights. Again, two pair. So two pairs are very minus EV. So we're folding two pair or worse, and we're calling everything that's better. Obviously, there's no sets here, so straights and flushes we're calling. And that's it. So, again, the lesson learned here, finally, what's the conclusion that we come to? We get donked on the river. Aggro player, we're calling top pair or better. Tighter player, we're folding two pair or worse. That's what we learn here. Max exploit. Let's just run the max exploit tool real quick. I'm going to go back to the 10 of clubs. We'll keep it on 10 of diamonds because then I got to go and sit there and change the freaking thing again. It'd be annoying. All right, we'll keep it on 10 of diamonds. Run the max exploit tool. I love the max exploit tool. It's a great tool. Oh, thank you there for the follow, by the way. I missed the fact that we added a follower here because I don't have... I don't know why I didn't get... Oh, because I don't have my sound on. That's why. So I apologize if I missed any other followers, by the way, in this stream. So we ran the max exploit tool. And this is what it says we should be doing. Full houses, obviously raising, of course. No matter what, we're shoving the full houses here. Flushes, all plus EV. Straights, same idea. It's all the same idea. Nothing's going to change here because Max Exploit's going to have us do the plus EV stuff. So there you go. I apologize for missing a new follower. 1 second. We'll be done in a minute here anyway. By the way, Hood, you weren't there yesterday, so never mind. It was a little dude that was there yesterday. I was going to say something, but... The microphone, I hope, is sounding good, by the way, for you guys. Oh, we got two new followers. I apologize for not noticing the new followers, by the way. JDR4 and OM and Angela4174. Thank you very much for following me if you're still here. I do apologize for missing that. It's because I don't have the sound on for the computer. Well, there's a new thing, Hooden, that every Monday night at 7 o'clock, we're going to be doing Monday study hour since I don't play on Mondays. So anyway, I appreciate everybody who checked out the stream. I'll be back tomorrow night playing. I'll be back about between 9 and 9:30 playing. We're here Tuesday night. Wednesday night, I think it starts about 8:30 or 9 o'clock. I have the schedule actually on my page. Thursday, Friday, Saturday, we usually play sometime during the day. And Sunday we play MTT. So I appreciate you guys checking out the stream and studying along with me. It was a lot of fun. Thank you, Holy's Poker. It was a lot of fun. And till next time, Poker Dad out. By the way, and I am putting this up on YouTube. So if you're watching this video on YouTube, please do me a favor and click the subscribe button. And yeah, there we go. Until next time. Oh, and if you're watching this on YouTube, also one more thing. Then follow me on Twitch, twitch.tv/PokerDad2878. Thank you for watching. Poker Dad, out. She's back in the atmosphere with drops of Jupiter in her